continue with our topics. After smart cities and smart buildings, we continue with cybersecurity. Cybersecurity within today's fast-moving and complex world creates multiple challenges. Why we shouldn't look at the myths, but instead focus on facts, is our next topic. We introduce our next speaker, Mr. Fred Strefland, Director of Cybersecurity at Hikvision. Mrs. Strefland, we kindly invite you to take our virtual stage.
Thank you very much. Good morning, good afternoon, good evening, wherever you are in the world. My name is Fred Strefland, and I am the Director of Cybersecurity for Hikvision. Today's presentation is about the myths. Well, it's more about the facts. And it's the title has, Don't Look at the Myths, but Focus on the Facts in the Security World. And it will also address how Hikvision builds towards transparent cybersecurity. And when I start a presentation, I always like to start with a quote. And in this case, it's a quote of a friend of mine, Mikko Hipponen. And he has this quote, whenever a device is smart, it's vulnerable. And you just heard a lot about smart cities and smart devices. And from a cybersecurity perspective, he tells you that whenever a device is smart, it's vulnerable. That means that it's hackable. And my quote is that, okay, it's a given that 100% cybersecurity is impossible, but you must not settle for less than 99.9%. So basically you have to do everything you can to make a device in this case as cybersecure as possible. I will come back to this later on. Let me first introduce myself very shortly and my company. My name is Fred Strefland. I'm working since 1992 in the intelligence and security domain. The first 20 years I served in the Air Force and the intelligence in the public sector, and the last 12 years I served in the private sector. I was a consultant for IBM. I was working in sales. I was a director of training and education, and I was even a CISO for several companies myself. And my final job, I was an advisor for Palo Alto Networks, working for Northern East Europe. And now I'm the director of cybersecurity for Europe, Middle East and Africa. Some words about Hikvision. A lot of you probably know Hikvision, Chinese company founded in 2001. It's evolved as to an IoT solutions provider with video as its core. It's a public company with more than 40,000 employees worldwide. And out of those 40,000 employees, we have more than 19,000 working in the R&D. So we are very innovative. We have more than 500 technology partners in 150 countries. So that's me, that's us. And let me go into today's challenging world, because we live in a day in a world which is very challenging. And this world is changed significantly in the last couple of years. So what we have seen is that we live in a highly digitalized world. And this world has very complex organizations. In the early days, the organizations were pretty simple. You had a building, and inside that building, there were some computers. And around the building, there was a fence, and there was some CCTV, some guards. And it was hard to get in. And it was also too hard to get out sometimes. And it was easy to protect this organization, because this organization was pretty simple. Again, the computers were inside. And when you went home, you left your computer in the building. Now, organizations are complex, and computers and data are everywhere. And at the same time, people are demanding that they have that data on their smartphones, on their mobile devices. So we get more and more demanding people in the world. On top of this, we have compliance and regulations that we have to comply to, that we have to adhere to. For example, GDPR. We have to comply to the GDPR, which is a challenge. It's a challenge for every company in the world, that privacy needs to be respected. And we do, we respect privacy. Another thing, and already mentioned in the previous speaker sessions, is Internet of Things. Well, there are lots of Internet of Things out there, and they're expected to be much more in the future. So Internet of Things is a big thing, because every device, as stated in my first slide, is vulnerable, because you don't expect that every Internet of Things device is protected significantly. Those devices are there with a purpose, but not with a security purpose most of the time. So Internet of Things is a big challenge. And on top of this, we have the 5G connectivity. And with 5G, things are going 100 times faster than with 4G. And with 5G, things are possible that are not possible with 4G. But it also brings along some risks. So this is challenging for us cybersecurity professionals. And besides those challenges that we basically see around in the world, we also have a threat. And this threat is highly automated. They didn't sit still in the last couple of years. They were evolving. And these bad guys, and I call them guys, but they're also girls in those groups, they are, again, highly automated. And they use machine learning. They use cloud computing. And again, highly automated. So that's a challenge for us. And on top of this, we have the COVID-19 outbreak. Well, that is a big challenge. And everybody in the world is influenced by this COVID-19 thing. And that's a challenge for us because people have to work from home. So what about your home network? What about the security of your home network? And what about the bad guys? They don't sit still. They know that you're working from home. So they attack home networks. And on top of this, every organization needs to grow. And these are the challenges that we are facing as cybersecurity professionals, as IT professionals. This is a challenging world. And on top of this challenging world, we have some myths. And some myths are things that are out there in the media and that are not true. They are myths. And just to give you some examples of the things that we see in the media are these kind of statements. Backdoor access found in Chinese internet devices, research say. Yes, China is probably watching us through our IoT devices. Is the world's biggest, largest surveillance camera maker sending footage to China? And Chinese surveillance cameras removed due to security concerns. So those are the myths that we are seeing out there in the media. And it's my pleasure of addressing those myths today and counter those myths and stick to the facts, because that's basically what I think we should do. So the question is how to handle the challenges that we are facing in the challenging world and how to counter the myths. And that's my purpose for today's 20-25 minutes. And the first thing I think, which is very important to counter myths, is to explain misperceptions. Because those are most of the time misperceptions, what we've seen. And if we look at those misperceptions, and I will get back to that later on, we need to explain the facts. And the second thing is also stick to the facts. We have to stick to the facts. And finally, we have to show transparency. I think it's very important to show transparency in everything you do. So this is key. So let's take a look at the first one, explain the misperceptions. And to give you an example, backdoor access found in Chinese internet devices. Well, what about backdoor? Backdoors, they are mentioned in the press a lot of times. Well, let me first explain this. Let me explain the difference between a backdoor and a vulnerability. A backdoor is an undocumented way of gaining access to computer system. A backdoor is a potential security risk. And to see the small letters, a backdoor is created on purpose, mostly during the production process. And this is the definition of the NIST, of the US NIST. But I think this is pretty clear. That's a backdoor. And if you look at a vulnerability, this is what a vulnerability is. The vulnerability is the existence of a weakness, design, or implementation error that can lead to an unexpected, undesirable event, compromising the security of a computer system, network, application, or protocol involved. And what you see here is that the vulnerability is non-intentional. And it's mostly identified as a CVE, common vulnerability and exposure. And what you see here is the difference between a backdoor and vulnerability is that the backdoor is set on purpose and a vulnerability is a weakness thing that can happen. And especially if you look at vulnerabilities, things happen. And there are weaknesses, design and implementation errors, especially in software. And to go a little bit into depth about vulnerabilities, to explain vulnerabilities, what you see is that there are vulnerabilities in IoT devices, as stated in the first slide by Mikko Hiponen. IP-based cameras and recorders are IoT devices. IoT devices are computers. All computers have vulnerabilities. That's a fact. And IP cameras and recorders might also have vulnerabilities. So that's a conclusion. And what you can see here, looking at the vulnerabilities, that there are a lot of vulnerabilities out there. And as I told you, especially in the software. And software code, it's hard to create software code without vulnerabilities. That is also a fact. And what you see here is the difference between the amount of lines of code of the different devices and applications. And what you see is that in the industry average, the average is that the developers, they develop software and they will have about 15 to 50 bugs in 1,000 lines of code. But well-programmed and tested lines of code contain 2 to 3 bugs per 1,000 lines of code. But that's still some bugs for 1,000 lines of code. And take a look at how many million lines of codes there are in a modern high-end car or in a Facebook application. And it's not for nothing that you receive every time on your mobile phone, you receive that you have to update your phone because there are bugs found and they have to improve those bugs. They have to patch them, as we call them. So that's a fact. There are vulnerabilities in software code. And if you look at the vendors with the most vulnerabilities and just take a look at the number of vulnerabilities, and I don't want to blame or bash any vendor, it's a fact. Things happen. And it's not about if you have vulnerabilities, but it's about how to deal with vulnerabilities. And if we then look at Hikvision as an example, well, if we look at backdoors and vulnerabilities, well, Hikvision has sold tens of millions of cameras and recorders around the world, but has never received any credible report or evidence of a backdoor being intentionally placed in our products. That's a fact. Since the foundation of Hikvision in 2001, only 14 vulnerabilities are reported within the Hikvision devices. And you can see the list in this website. And take a look at the previous slide. We saw a couple of thousand vulnerabilities that other vendors have. So 14 is not a lot. And finally, which I think is very important to mention, is that Hikvision is a CVE numbering authority, which means that it's obliged to report and solve vulnerabilities publicly. Which means that if we have a vulnerability either detected by ourselves or somebody else, they will tell us, hopefully, and we have to report this publicly and we have to solve this publicly. And there are only 140 CNE organizations in the world. So there are some competitors that are not a CNE. Well, you can ask then yourself the question, well, how open are they? How transparent are they? Well, we have to be. And that is something about backdoors and vulnerabilities. So explain misperceptions, the first thing. If we look at the second part, stick to the facts. We also look at assumptions. China is probably watching us. China is doing espionage, is sending footage to China. Well, these are assumptions. These are not the facts. And if we look at those facts, well, we know that things can happen. And if you look at this picture, and this is a picture that comes from our white paper, is that in an ecosystem of, in this case, digital surveillance camera, we have an application layer, a transport layer, and a perception layer. And in all those three layers, things can happen. And you can see in the red what can happen in those different layers. So things can happen. But if we look at Hikvision and what we do with our video cameras, well, we protect video footage. So we cannot send it to China because we most of the time work in a closed circuit. And also what we do is we protect our video footage. If we send it to something, we protect it with HTTPS. And also we protect it with digital watermarking, and we do more about this. So all the things that can happen, we try to do our best to prevent it. As I stated in the first page, we try to do 99.9% our best to protect video footage. And on top of this, we don't store any video data because it's not our importance or responsibility to store data. It's the end user and customer, who is the data processor in GDPR terms, that decides what to do with the video data. So we provide the cameras. We don't store any video data if the customer doesn't want us. We don't do that. So we cannot even send it to China if people think that we are doing that. And this is very important to make this clear. And also what we do is to protect the devices, we use secure by design. And security by design is what you can see here is that we do everything we can in the different elements of the device. We secure the device itself. We secure the data, as I mentioned in the previous slide. We secure the application and we secure the network also, what we can secure. So this is a picture also from our product cybersecurity white paper that tells you what we do about it to protect the data in a video surveillance system in this case. And what are we doing? What about Hikvision? The same question. Well, we apply this security by design and we do code review and pen testing during and after the production. We cannot, a Hikvision device cannot be switched on with a default password. So the access control is very important and the user must set a unique strong password to for a device to operate. And finally, we have a Hikvision security response center, which is responding to and handling customer submitted security incidents and security matters announced by the industry associations. We are analyzing vulnerabilities, not backdoors, vulnerabilities, and patch them according the things we have to patch them according being a CNE. And we are formulating the company's information security incident management strategy. So again, we do everything we can to make sure that we stick to the security rules and we respect privacy. And then finally, how do we show transparency? Because I think it's very important. And what I see sometimes is that Chinese surveillance cameras, not only our cameras, also our competitors, are removed due to security concerns. People say, yeah, there are backdoors in the cameras. There are security concerns. Cybersecurity is not well done within these cameras. Well, and I would say it's the opposite. So that's also why we show transparency. We have a source code transparency center. We are, I think, still the only one in the security industry who has a source code transparency center. At least we were the first one. Transparency center is located in the US, but it's open for everybody all over the world if they want to review the source code. So it enables government agencies from the US, from Canada, but also from Europe, even from Asia, to visit this transparency center and to watch, to review the source code. This is very important. So we want to be transparent and also to show that we do our best, to show that we take security and privacy very seriously. We have achieved several industry certificates, industry security certificates. ISO 27001, the FIPS 140-2, the SOC 2, we have a CMI level 5, and we even have common criteria certifications in-house. And to give you an example, the FIPS 140-2 is a US government standard to evaluate and validate the encryption that we are using within our cameras and make sure that this encryption achieved the level which is needed to certify those IP cameras and recorders. So this is very important for us to show, to be transparent about what we are doing. And finally, we have two regional directors. And those two regional directors, they are not salespersons. They are there to assist employees, but also to assist you guys, to assist end users with cybersecurity issues. So whenever you have a question about cybersecurity, if you have a concern, please don't hesitate to contact myself if you are located in Europe, Middle East, or Africa, or if you're located outside in the Americas, in Australia, New Zealand, and Asia Pacific. Please contact my colleague, Chuck Davis. And we are there to assist you. And again, don't hesitate to contact us. We are there to assist and to help because we think cybersecurity needs to be done. And it's a responsibility of everybody. And we can only do this and if we work together, because the bad guys work together. So we should work together, I think, and that's important. So this brings me to the conclusion, as I stated, 20 to 25 minutes. So it leaves some time for question. Well, the conclusion of my short story is that we live in a complex world and cybersecurity for IoT is challenging. And of course, I understand that there are things out there in the media that are not always correct, that have different perceptions, that make accusations that are not true. I understand it. It's not easy, but stick to the facts. I think that is very important. And it's not easy. Cybersecurity is not easy. Just take a look at the amount of software code that is in a device. It is not easy. It is challenging. But again, we should do everything we can to sort this out and to solve these issues. There are several myths within the security world, like backdoors, espionage, and other risk concerns, mostly focused to Chinese vendors in this case. But again, these are myths. These are not facts. And that's also one of the reasons why we say that, yes, we understand those things are out there, but we are always willing to explain those misperceptions. We want to stick to the facts and we show transparency. And of course, people make mistakes, so do we. But at least we show that we do everything to do it good. And one of the things is that we put a lot of effort in our vulnerability management. If there's a vulnerability out there in one of our products, inform us and we help to solve this. And also that's our task. As a CNE, it's our mandatory task that we have to do this. We have to be open. We have to do this out in the public. Security by design during our production process. And I can tell you, this is done very seriously. We use a lot of code reviewing. We do pen testing. The fact that you cannot use default passwords to operate a camera. And we have our Hikvision Security Response Center. So we have a lot of things in place to make our products as cyber resilient as possible. And also we like to show this. We have our Source Code Transparency Center. We have international certifications and we have our regional cybersecurity directors, of which I am one of them. So again, that is the conclusion of my short story. And I will now open the floor for questions. And if you have any questions afterwards, please don't hesitate to contact me. These are my contact details. You can also find me on LinkedIn. And I want to thank you very much for your attention. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Mr. Strefland. We have a few questions for you as well. So for a start, can we refer to, let's call it, USA-China economy issues? If I'm not wrong, Hikvision was also on some constraints when it refers to that.
Yes, that's correct. Within the US, there is a list out there that is that some Chinese companies are on constraints in the US. Absolutely.
Okay, can you a bit elaborate how it affected Hikvision and is it sold right now?
Well, I cannot comment on that because it's not my expertise. So I'm a cybersecurity expert. So I'm there again to assist our people, but also our customers with cybersecurity issues. And I'm not a political affairs person. So I cannot really comment on that in depth. The only thing is that it's a fact that the US government has banned some Chinese companies, but that is more a political game than it's based on in this case, cybersecurity concerns.
Okay, we will move away from political questions, of course. Can you tell us what is the safety perception of Hikvision's products on the West?
You want me to say a little bit about the safety?
Yeah. The perception in market.
Well, the perception, as far as I can say something about that, because like I said, I'm not a customer, I'm working for Hikvision. But if I talk with customers and if I talk with installers and distributors, they say that some customers or prospects, they have those concerns, as I addressed, that they have concerns that like, well, it's a Chinese company, so probably you guys do espionage for the Chinese government. How cyber secure are your cameras? What about the data protection? So, of course, I also get those questions, and then I refer back to the things that I just mentioned in my presentation. Well, stick to the facts. These are the facts. This is what we do to make our products as cyber secure as possible. This is what we do to respect privacy, because I think that's a very important thing. I get a lot of questions about privacy concerns in Europe with the GDPR in mind. And also, we also have to stick to the GDPR. So that means that all the data that we use for our own company, we also have to respect the GDPR and do data and put data protection out there. So it does, it's not a change from our customers. So I get those questions. And again, I will always answer them with the facts, with stick to the facts. So please let me explain what we do about it. Again, these are perceptions of customers. So you cannot take away perceptions from customers or prospects, but it's just that, again, I counter those perceptions with the facts that I also addressed in this presentation.
Okay. And one more thing, what we would like to hear from you is, does Hikvision now have any major projects, announcements that are upcoming that you would like to share with us, or something that's coming in let's say, few weeks or months?
Well, that's a good question, but ask to the wrong person. I'm not a salesperson, which means that I don't know what we are doing in this perspective. The only thing I can say that we are constantly innovating our products, also based on requests by customers. So we are constantly improving things. I think on our website, there is a lot of product announcements on a constant, continuously, I have to say. So that's the only thing I can say. I can say you one thing, which is something that I am contacted from our HQ in China, and they asked me, well, we want to develop this product, and we have developed this product. How can we make sure that the GDPR is respected in this product? So what do we have to do to make this product GDPR compliant? So, and I think that's a very good thing. And that's also the way how we do this, how we have to do this, that when we bring a product to the market, make sure that it addresses privacy and cybersecurity. So I can tell you this, that again, 2 weeks ago, I got this question. So I'm working in a project on this product that to make it privacy and cybersecurity resilient. Hopefully that answers the question.
Yes. Mr. Strefan, thank you. We won't take more of your time. Thank you, really.
Thank you very much, and a pleasure to be here. Thank you.
Thank you.